morning all. So today we are going to discuss about the second part of module 3, that is based upon antenna. Okay, now this antenna from module 3, half of the part is the basic parameter what we are going to discuss with respect to the antenna. What are the basic parameters available with respect to antenna? What are the characteristics are there? How many features are there with respect to antenna? What are the components we are going to identify? So each and everything we will go through in a very brief manner with respect to the characteristics of a particular radiating element. So as you can see, the antenna basically is called as a radiating element. One minute. It acts as a radiating element. We have seen that circulator, when we are seeing that working principle of the circulator and what is the how the circulator is used for the duplexers also. In duplexer we have a radiating element. In that radiating element we can transmit the signal as well as we can receive the signal. But these signals are what sort of signal? These signals are called electromagnetic waves. So when we are transmitting the signal, the electrical energy or the electrical pulses, modulated pulses, are going to be converted into the electromagnetic waves with the help of a radiating element. Similarly, when we are receiving something, when we are receiving some electromagnetic waves with the help of some receiving antenna, it will convert that electromagnetic energy into the electrical pulses. And those electrical pulses enter to the receiver end, and in the receiver, demodulation takes place and extraction of information will be done. So this is the basic principle how this particular antenna will work. Antenna is nothing but an element which can convert one form of energy into the another form of energy. One form of energy means when we want to transmit the signal, electrical pulses are converted into electromagnetic waves. Okay, and in which wavelength is less and frequency component is high. So for long distance communication, frequency component need to be very very high, so that it need to be incorporated with respect to the transmitted signals. Similarly, when we are receiving these signals, the electromagnetic energy is converted into the electrical signal, and electrical signals most probably either with respect to amplitude or with respect to frequency we can extract the information. Okay, so this is the basic means idea about the antenna. But what are the features, what are the components are available with respect to antenna, how we are going to identify the radiation pattern, how the radiation will take place, what are the radiating elements, how many type of antennas are there, on which particular parameter the antenna depends, all those things we will see one by one. Okay, so here I have drawn few antennas, and what are the basic features are there that we will go through with following discussion. So as you can see, there are different sort of antennas are there. One, dipole antenna, then loop antenna, helical antenna, pyramidal antenna and coaxial antenna. Or this is, you can say, this is called as a reflector, or the, it comes under that parabolic antenna, this one. This is called as a parabolic antenna. Okay. Now one by one we will discuss all this thing. So first we should understand what are the characteristics or what are the basic features for a particular antenna when it is going to be radiate some signals. So as I have written, it must be efficient in radiation. Means whatever the input signal is given at a low potential, it must radiate the maximum output. So maximum output means your maximum transfer theorem come into picture. So as you can see, I have drawn two antennas. One is for transmitting side and one is for the receiving side. So when we are transmitting some signals, the potential is, or the electrical signals up to this, it is electrical signal when it is comes out from a particular metallic plate to the free space, then it is called as a electromagnetic waves. And how that electromagnetic wave, that also we will see how it is related and what are the features are there. Okay, so now once it is comes into the free space, it becomes an electromagnetic waves. Now the electromagnetic waves will propagate towards the receiver end. At the receiver end, what happens, the electromagnetic waves strike to the radiating element, at that time the receiver will work, and with the help of duplexer it will terminate the transmitter part and activate the receiver signal, what we have seen in our circulator application. So once the electrical signals are converted, EM wave is converted to electrical signals, you can extract easily your message signal. So that means it is an efficient radiation, okay, efficient manner of radiation. Second, impedance matching must be done. Impedance matching means the impedance of the radiating element must match with the impedance of the wave or impedance of a free space in which it is going to be delivered, so that maximum information can be delivered. And reflection coefficient must be zero. That means your load impedance and the characteristics impedance, if it is equal, maximum information can be delivered and no reflection will be there. Due to the no reflection, no losses will be there. So that maximum information we have transmitted, we can judge. The thing is that the impedance of this radiating element must be same, or it must be matched with the impedance of a particular medium or particular space in which we have delivered the signal. So once if this impedance was matched, maximum information we have transmitted. So maximum information when we are going to transmit, that means reflection losses is zero, reflection losses is negligible, due to which power losses is also negligible, and we have efficiently transmit our signal. So it is called efficient radiation. So these two statements are interrelated with each other. If it is efficient radiation means impedance matching must be done. The impedance matching means impedance of this radiating element and the space where it is going to be delivered. So that free space is also having some impedance. So if the impedance are matched, that means maximum information can be delivered. So these are the two important facts for a radiating element, as well as it can receive the signals also for a particular antenna specific. Okay. Now, if I want to analyze this working of this antenna, so what are the parameters I must understand first? So before entering to the what are the features of an antenna, we should just have a look up with respect to our Maxwell equation. The Maxwell equation or the relationship between electric field and magnetic field. It is in with respect to the static condition as well as with respect to the time varying. Now here I can't consider the static, here I will consider with respect to time varying. Why? Because the waves are propagating in a certain medium and the waves are not static, these are oscillating condition. Variations will be there with respect to time. So if any physical quantity which varies with respect to time, that means it is a time dependent function. So here when it is delivered to a free space, it becomes as a time dependent. If it is a time dependent, that means we can represent the signal easily in a frequency domain. So if it is a frequency is very very high, that means it will take less time to reach to a receiver end. Okay, because frequency and this time period is inversely proportional to each other. So what are the features we will see with respect to the Maxwell equation? First of all, we need to identify the electric field and magnetic field. Because when we are radiating something, that means the potential and the current. When I am transmitting some signal, here I will have V and I. But this V and I is converted into E and H signal. E is the electric field and H is the magnetic field. So we have to form that relation. What is that relation? One is V is equals to minus E dot dl, and then I is equals to H dot dl. So these are the two basic equations through which we can form a relationship between potential and current with respect to electric field and magnetic field. So when it is within the conductor, the current and potential need to be identified. When it is out of the conductor, means radiating element, we need to represent in terms of electric field and magnetic field. So these are the two relations which is comes under our static as well as for our time varying. But in time varying, what happens if the any of the electric field or magnetic field changes, the other factor is also going to change. because when we are transmitting the signal, both signals are transmitted, electric field as well as magnetic field. If electric field varies, it will affect the magnetic field also. Or if the magnetic field varies, it will affect the electric field also. That relation we have seen with respect to the Maxwell time-varying equations. One is Faraday law and one is with respect to the displacement current. So one is Faraday law means induced EMF you can identify with rate of change of flux in that particular loop. So if there is a rate of decrease of flux in that loop, some potential drop will be there. So that is called induced EMF due to the variation of magnetic flux. Okay. Similarly, so first of all, we need to analyze which particular system it is, whether it is a rectangular system we have to analyze, whether we have to analyze with respect to cylindrical system, whether we have to analyze with respect to the spherical system, because different sort of mediums are there. If you consider the medium is a rectangular system, or if you consider in your room which is a rectangular in shape or a square in shape, then you can analyze all these parameters in terms of rectangular system. But if the medium is with respect to circular waveguide, okay, then I can't use the rectangle. I have to analyze with respect to cylindrical system. If my waveguide is a spherical system, okay, sometime it will be spherical. That means I have to analyze with respect to spherical coordinate system. So that is the first step. You have to analyze with respect to the coordinate system. That means you have to understand the medium, three-dimensional view in which particular wave is propagating. Okay. So after identifying the coordinate system, you have to identify the vector magnetic potential, that is called A, vector magnetic potential. That means indirectly we are calculating H, and from H we have to calculate with respect to the electric field. How? Let's see. So if the vector potential is known, then we can proceed to find out the magnetic field intensity. So magnetic field intensity H is equals to del cross A we can write, as well as B is equals to mu into H also we can write. These are the basic relation. B is the flux density, magnetic flux density. H is the magnetic field intensity. If B is equals to mu H, it will be in terms of Weber per meter square or Tesla. Okay. And that is equals to del cross A. Del cross A means the magnetic fields are rotational in nature, and that vector magnetic potential is capital A. So once this H is identified, next you can proceed to determine electric field. Now how we are going to identify electric field? We have a relation, intrinsic impedance is equals to E by H. Okay, intrinsic impedance is eta, which is having a relation with respect to electric field and magnetic field, that is E by H. Okay, and that E by H, either you can determine with respect to E, eta is equals to E by H, or with the help of Maxwell equation also we can determine, that is del cross H is equals to epsilon del E by del T. Here one more component is sigma E is also available, but sigma is not considered. Why? Because when the wave is in air medium, in a free space, conductivity is zero. So here the conductivity terms is zero. So here that component you can neglect. So it is epsilon into del E by del T. So it is del cross H is equals to epsilon del E by del T you can determine, or you can go for eta is equals to E by H. Okay. But the condition is the electric field and magnetic field both must be perpendicular to each other, and it must be perpendicular to the direction of propagation of wave. Suppose if wave is total wave is propagating along Z axis, your electric field must propagate along X axis and magnetic field must propagate along Y axis, or vice versa, but in terms of negative sign. Okay. So once the determination of electric field is known, once the determination of magnetic field is known, you can identify the total radiated power. How? First you have to calculate the average power, what you are going to transmit, and you have to multiply that average power with respect to the cross section, because the assumption of that cross section in which particular direction, whether it is moving in X axis, whether it is moving along Y axis, or whether it is moving along Z axis, according to that, that area you have to identify. Okay, and that area is multiplied with the average power to get the radiated power. So here you can see radiated P suffix R rad is called as a radiated power, which is average power into the cross section, in which particular direction it is moving and what is the cross section of that medium, that we have to identify. Okay, if it is a cylindrical system, suppose if the wave is propagating along z axis, in cylindrical system we have three axes. One is radius of a cylinder, that is rho. One is the height of the cylinder, that is along z axis, we have to assume. And one is the azimuthal angle, that means it indicates the curvature of that particular cylinder. Okay, so in these three dimension or direction, in which direction the electric field or magnetic field both are propagating, my power is propagating, according to that I have to choose my area, and that average area we have to multiply with the cross section so that the radiated power can be determined. What is this average power? Average power is nothing but half of real of ES cross HS, that means pointing vector. Okay, so this is half of real of ES cross H complex. It will give you the average power. If you multiply that average power in a certain direction of cross section, then you can identify the radiated power. So these are the four basic steps through which we can analyze that how much power content we are going to deliver in a particular medium with the help of a radiating element. So what are the first step? First, we have to identify the cross section dimension. Either we are going for Cartesian system, either we are going for cylindrical system, either we are going for spherical system. Once this system is freezed, you have to determine the vector magnetic potential. Okay, once the vector magnetic potential is known, then you can determine the magnetic field. So H can be identified with del cross A. From that you can determine B also. B is the magnetic flux density. Similarly, once the H component is known, you can determine E component also, because whenever we are discussing about EM wave, E and H both have the same importance. We cannot deliver the information only with respect to electric field or only with respect to magnetic field. It is not like that. We have to use both the component, and both the component must be perpendicular to each other. Okay, once H is known, go for determination of E, and once E and H both are known, go for the radiated power. So for different antenna, different radiation relation will be there, because this radiation power basically identified with respect to the resistance also, because P is equals to I square R. So radiation resistance for different antenna is different. For loop antenna, the radiation resistance is different. For helical antenna, radiation resistance is different. For dipole antenna, radiation resistance is different. And these all radiation resistance depend upon the length of the antenna. Because radiation resistance, since it is a resistance, it depends upon rho L by A. Remember this relation. So your radiation resistance also depends upon the length of a particular antenna. Whether it is a lambda by 2 length, whether it is a lambda by 4 length, or whether it is a lambda by 8 length. Depend upon that, you have to calculate the radiation resistance. So these are the basic antenna structure. This is halfway, it is called as a dipole antenna. Dipole means this is act as a positive and this will act as a negative. And your electric field will moving from positive to negative like this, radiating element. So upper one is highly positive and lower one is negative. That means the current is moving in this particular direction and it will enter and it will move out. So this is current is moving out, here the current is entering like this. So this is called as our dipole antenna. It is having two poles. One is positive, one is negative. And due to the positive and negative, the electric fields are generated, and due to the flow of current, the magnetic fields will be generated. And both electric field and magnetic fields are perpendicular to each other. Okay, we will discuss all these things in a very explanatory manner, but for how it works and all, just I will discuss now. Next one is the loop antenna. Here you can see it is a square loop. It can be a circular loop also. Okay, here I have written it is a square loop, but it will be a, it can be a circular loop, it can be a this rectangular, or it is a square loop, it is a elliptical loop, any sort of loop will be there. So it is called as a loop antenna. So here also the current moves in this particular direction, and current will move out in this particular direction. Similarly, due to the positive charge, electric field will generate. Due to the flow of current, the magnetic field will be generated. Similarly, this is called as our helical antenna. Okay, helical antenna will have a helix, that dimensions is also there. With the help of the dimension, we can identify the electric field and magnetic field. So this is one sort of antenna that is called helical antenna. Similarly, here you can see it is called pyramidical antenna. It is called pyramid. It is in terms of pyramid. This is nothing but a flank. Okay, these are the flanks, and this depends upon E plane and H plane. Means this pyramidal is available either with respect to E plane pyramidic or H plane pyramidal. We will discuss all these things very brief manner. But for the time being, you recognize the what are the types of antennas available. Next, it is a parabolic antenna. You can see this is called parabola. In D2H connections, they used to use this parabolic antenna. Okay, in VSAT also they will use the parabolic antenna. They will have one receptors, and with the help of the convex lens principle, it will extract, it will receive the signal and project it to a focal point. From that focal point, the radiating element will convert the electromagnetic energy into the electrical pulses. Okay, the dimension will depends upon the axis of a parabola. Okay, so these are the basic type of antenna, and the analysis basically depends upon these four, because anyway at the end we have to calculate the radiated power, because what it is radiating, how much power it is radiating, which antenna gives more radiating power depend upon the dimension. Either it is dipole antenna, either it is loop antenna, either it is helical antenna, or either it is parabolic antenna, or either it is pyramidal antenna. Different antenna is having different applications. Okay, because the dimension changes means resistance is also going to change, as well as your electric field and magnetic field are also going to change with respect to certain purpose. Okay, so this is the basic features of an antenna, and then we will see what are the characteristics of an antenna. How, what are the features are there? What are the characteristics? Suppose if I will say, let us consider Ram is a boy. Okay, so his height is 5 feet 11 inches, weight is 75 kilogram. He is a very bright student. So if I will say what is the characteristics of that Ram, then how we can define? He is having certain height. The height is one component. He is having certain skin color, skin tone, that is also one component. How he speak, that is also a component. How he walk, how he behave, that is also one component. Similarly, our antenna will also perform depend upon those particular features, and depend upon that features, the different antenna will have different parameters or different resultant with respect to the same features. Same features means if I will say directivity, if I will say gain, if I will say radiated power, if I will say radiation resistance, these all parameter will be different for different antenna, but the characteristics resultant will be same for all. That means all are human. Okay, if I will say boy and girl, but both are human, but the characteristics is different. Similarly, antennas depend upon the cross section. So if the cross section changes, these all parameters are going to change, but the name will be remain as it is. Okay, we will see all those things step by step. Okay, so as I have discussed that there are basic characteristics of a particular antenna will be there, and on that particular characteristics, different values are identified for a different sort of antenna, for short dipole, for quarter wave dipole, for loop antenna, for helical antenna. The different values will be identified, but the procedure will be same. It only differs with respect to the dimension and the analysis. Okay, so step by step we will see. So what are the antenna characteristics? Okay, first of all, antenna pattern is identified. Antenna pattern means field pattern, either it is an electric field or a magnetic field. If you combine it, it will become as a field pattern with respect to electric field and magnetic field. And we also calculate the power pattern also. Okay, so that comes under your antenna pattern, means how that radiating fields are analyzed, how that electric field and how magnetic fields are analyzed, that is comes under this radiation or antenna pattern things. Next one is the radiation intensity. For example, if I am transmitting some signal, okay, I am the radiating element and I am transmitting some signal, what is the intensity of the signal measured at a certain distance? That is called as a radiation resistance or radiation intensity. You can say it is called radiation intensity. Okay. Similarly, we have directive gain. Means when I am transmitting a signal in a particular direction, this directive word comes from the direction. Okay. So directive gain. So directive gain is identified when we are transmitting the signal in a particular direction. Okay. So it comes under directivity also. What we have seen in our directivity in our directional coupler, directivity, coupling coefficient, isolation, and one more is insertion loss. So these are the certain factor what we have seen in our waveguides. Same with respect to similar thing, now we have to identify all these parameter. Next one is our power gain, means at what gain we are transmitting the signal as well as we are receiving the signal. The gain must be identified. Okay. Then beam efficiency, means whatever the signal I am transmitting, it is nothing but a beam and it is projected in a certain direction. And directivity will be there. So these all are interrelated with each other. Beam efficiency, what is the efficient way to transmit this signal? Okay. And we have the antenna aperture. Antenna aperture means area, whether it is a half wave dipole, whether it is a quarter wave dipole, whether it is a helical antenna, whether it is a loop antenna, it identifies the cross section aperture. Okay. Or you can consider it is a parabolic antenna. What is the aperture of this parabolic, that we can calculate easily. Okay. And next one, effective height, it also plays a vital role. Always remember, we have seen in our PCS that we have discussed the when we are transmitting the signal, it depends upon the height, the need of modulation. The need of modulation comes with a small point, that is called depend upon antenna height. So if the antenna height is small, you can transmit the large number, means higher frequency component, because it is directly related with respect to the wavelength. As much as the wavelength is less, your height of the antenna is less. As much as the wavelength is less, frequency component is very, very high. If the frequency component is very, very high, that means the antenna height must be very, very less. Okay. So depend upon all those features, we can calculate the parameters for different antenna. For helical antenna, we can find out for this. For half wave dipole, we can find out all this parameter. For Hertzian dipole, we can identify for all this figure. For loop antenna, we can identify all these relations. So step by step we will see. So first we will analyze what is antenna pattern. Okay. Antenna pattern means field pattern. Electric field, magnetic field. If you combine these two, electric field and magnetic field, how it will look like. Okay. Now, before entering to this antenna pattern, few points I want to discuss, that how these patterns are analyzed, how this pattern can be represented. Okay. So first, 3D plot of its radiation of a far field. Now, when we are transmitting some signal, a radiating element is required. I will discuss all those things in next class also. When we are radiating something, it falls under three basic reasons. The radiating element, or you can say antenna, when it is transmitting the signals, basically three regions were identified. One, near region, means near to the particular radiating element. Next one is the reactive near field. Reactive near field means it is quite distance between that radiating element. And the far field region, which is the very much far, means large distance. If I will show, suppose this is my radiating element, okay? This radiating element is having certain region like this, okay? This distance from this first dotted line, this distance let us consider R1, from this distance let us consider R2, okay? Near field region means, near field region means it is within this R1, within this R1. And the reactive near field region means it is within R1 and R2. And the far field means outside of this R2. So this is called far field region. Okay. But this near field region, this reactive near field region and the far field region having basic name, this R1 to R2 means R lies between R1 to R2 is called as Fresnel zone. This is called Fresnel zone. And if R is greater than R2, then it is called Fraunhofer zone. Okay, there are basically three zones are there. So depend upon those three zones, we have to analyze it. Whether we are analyzing in far field, whether we are analyzing in reactive near field, whether we are analyzing in this near field. So when we are analyzing certain radiation pattern, always we have to choose the far field. Then only we can identify the variations of electric field and magnetic with respect to the dimension or with respect to the space. But if it is near to this, it is very, very negligible to identify the variation of electric field and magnetic field. It is only a small wave. You cannot discriminate between electric field and magnetic field, but EM wave it is. But at the far field, we can identify the pattern, how it looks like, what are the patterns are there, in which particular thing it depends. Okay? So that is the first one. So it is a three-dimensional plot of a radiation at a far field. So we have to analyze at a far field. Then next, basically we have two fields. One is electric field, one is magnetic field. Remember that when we are analyzing with respect to electric field, that means it is called as a voltage pattern. Okay, voltage pattern, because we have a relation V is equals to minus E dot dl. If you analyze E, that means indirectly you are analyzing V also. So it is a voltage pattern. If you are analyzing magnetic field, that means you are analyzing indirectly the current pattern also. Okay, so that is the E field is identified. Then next, if E field is known, potential is known, if you square that E field or potential, you will get the power pattern. Okay, so with respect to that E, with respect to E also you can determine power pattern, as well as with respect to current also you can determine power pattern. If you take I square, it will give you as a power relation. P is equals to I square R. Similarly, if it is with respect to voltage, V square by R will give as your power pattern. So, third point is, square the amplitude of E field, you will get your power pattern. Okay? Then, how we are going to analyze? That is a very unique question to how we are identifying these fields. Remember that when we are transmitting some signals, radiating some signals, we will see that all these patterns are spherical in nature. I will discuss one by one. Spherical in nature. So when it is radiating patterns are spherical in nature, you people have seen donuts. In the donut, it is a spherical in nature. If you cut that particular in a TS section, a small semicircular form will be there. That semicircular form is a combination of E field and H field. If you combine all those things and put an element in between that donut, that means the radiating patterns will be generated with respect to electric field and with respect to magnetic field. One. Next, how we are going to analyze the electric field and magnetic field, in which direction, that comes into picture. Now, this is one radiating element, let us consider. Okay. And in this radiating element, we are measuring a intensity at a certain distance r. Okay, so that means we are moving in a particular direction of ar. In spherical system, we have three direction: ar, a theta, and a phi. Then, now when I am analyzing the radiating field, this element is radiating the electric field and magnetic field, and I am identifying at a point P, which is at a distance r, at a certain distance. At a certain distance, we are identifying the intensity of both electric field and magnetic field. So that means, in this particular ar, which other two component remain constant? Other component is a theta and a phi. So that means, your electric field and magnetic field are perpendicular to each other, and we are measuring the intensity at this direction. So, direction of total wave is along AR, but electric field and magnetic field are propagating in other two directions. One is theta and one is phi. Okay. So, here I have took ES versus theta, HS versus phi. Now, both are perpendicular. R, theta, phi, both are perpendicular to each other. Here, if I will say this is AR, this is A theta, and this is A phi, all are perpendicular to each other. So if a total wave is propagating along r direction, that means E and H are in other direction, so it satisfies the perpendicular with respect to both as well as with respect to the direction of wind. So here I have to ES versus theta for constant phi. That means electric field and theta, electric field need to be varied along theta direction for a constant phi. Azimuthal angle will be constant for that. Similarly, when we are analyzing magnetic field will be analyzed with respect to phi. That means a complete rotation like this. Okay? It is a complete rotation in horizontal manner. Electric field in vertical manner. Okay? In vertical manner. So for a constant theta as a horizontal pattern, as I have told, and the electric field is with respect to the vertical pattern. So when horizontal and vertical mix with each other, it will form like as a donut. Okay, that means suppose this is a donut. Okay, and electric fields and magnetic fields are moving like this. These are, and radiating elements will be there. So radiating elements will be like this. So if you cut these two, it will look like this. It will look like as a cut section of a donut. And we'll say how this happens. Okay. So first, ES is moving along theta direction. We have to identify ES with respect to theta and HS with respect to phi. So that total wave is propagating along AR direction. Okay. Next. So constant this one. It is done. Next. How we are going to analyze it? Let us consider a short dipole. I will explain all those things when we are discussing about the different sort of antennas are there. But for the time being, I will only discuss how these patterns are observed. Okay. Now for the short dipole, basically it is a function of either sine theta or cos theta. So here I have considered short dipole. It will, when we are deriving all those things, the short dipole function depends upon sine theta. Okay. So let us consider f of theta is equals to sine theta, and that is with respect to the E plane. So E plane pattern, f of theta is equals to sine theta, and theta varies from 0 to 180 degree. So here you can see, this is the radiating element, this is the radiating element which radiate both the fields, and this is one complete and this is one. That means 0 to 180 degree it is covering. Okay. So it is just like as an infinite symbol, and it is radiating the element in both the sides, and its angle varies from 0 to 180 degree. Now you can see this one as a vertical in nature, okay, with respect to what? Z and X axis. Electric field is moving along now X axis, and it is having an angle theta, as we have said that ES versus theta, so theta is varying. Then similarly, for H plane pattern, it must be perpendicular to E. So perpendicular means theta must be 90 degree. So here I have to theta is equal to 90 degree. So my F of theta will be how much? F of theta is 1. 1 means it is a circular in nature. Unit circle. So this is my H plane pattern. Circular in nature. Okay. Now this circular and this particular infinite symbol, if I will combine this, it will become as a donut. So here you can see this particular part and this particular part indicates the presence of electric field, and this whole part, this is whole part, front side I have cut, so this whole part is called as our magnetic field. So this is the three dimensional plot for the electric field and magnetic field, and these are called as a pattern, antenna pattern. Either electric field or magnetic field, depends upon this we can analyze the transmission of signals. So when it is a dipole, it will form as a curve function. So one will be in terms of theta, one will be in terms of phi. Both are perpendicular to each other. Whenever this dipole comes, remember that the radiation pattern will look like as a donut. Okay, if it is circular in nature, magnetic field. If it is a curves, that means it is called as a electric fields. And if you cut that section, it will look like this. So this is the 3D pattern for electric field and magnetic field. For a example, I have considered as a short dipole. So these are the certain features. So for different sort of antenna, different radiation patterns are identified depend upon the cross section. If it is a rectangular system, your electric field and magnetic field will come in terms of rectangular manner. If it is a circular system, your electric field and magnetic field will be analyzed with respect to the cylindrical system. If it is spherical, as I have told, this is a radiating element, we are taking along AR, that means it is a spherical system. We have to analyze in terms of spherical in nature, depend upon the cross section. Okay. So this is the antenna pattern. Next we will discuss about the radiation intensity. Okay, so this is the pattern. We have seen the three-dimensional pattern for a dipole antenna. It is looks like as a donut. If you cut that donut from any side of section, that round section it will come. Two round section and one curve. These two round section indicate the presence of electric field, and that curve indicate the presence of magnetic field. Okay. Now, since as I have told that if the electric field is known, if you square it, we will get the power pattern. Or if the magnetic field is known, if you square it, also we will get the power pattern. Only the analysis will be different. If you consider with respect to electric field, the electric field versus theta terms you have to analyze for a constant azimuthal angle. If you are considering with respect to magnetic field, you have to consider with respect to phi. And theta must be constant, that is pi by 2. So, as I have written, average power at a fixed distance we have to measure. Either we have to measure with respect to theta, with respect to phi. If you are measuring with respect to theta, that means we are analyzing electric field, with respect to electric field. And if you are analyzing with respect to phi, that means we are analyzing the magnetic field, square component, average power. Okay, and what is P average? The P average is equals to half of real E cross H complex. Okay, so this is the average power. This average power, when we multiply with respect to certain cross section, you will get the radiated power. Okay, now when we are analyzing with respect to E field for short dipole, f of theta function we are writing in terms of sine theta, f of sine theta. But when we are considering with respect to power, that means to square it. So f of theta will be square as f square of theta, and we will get sine square of theta. Then, so sine square of theta means it will, the lobes will be quite lateral in nature, it will slightly expand, the value will be expand, the value will decrease. Means the amplitude will decrease. Okay, so here you can see the amplitudes are decreasing, and it is goes, and again it is continuing with respect to satisfy 0 to 180 degree. So this is with respect to the E field. Now with respect to magnetic field, you have to make theta as pi by 2, and you have to take the square of that one. So if sine theta at theta pi by 2, this function will become 1 and square of 1 will become 1. So it remains as it is. For magnetic field, it remains as it is. Unit circle. 1 square is also 1. So it remains as it is. So if you take and combine these two, you will get as a power pattern. So power pattern will look like this. So this is my electric field, and this is the electric field, magnetic field. Okay. So this is the power pattern. It will come like this. Okay, little bit stretch, amplitude will be less because we are increasing the square component. If the amplitude of that sine theta is half, if you square it, it will give you 1/4, 0.25, so amplitude reduces. Okay, so this is the power pattern for that half wave dipole. Next we have to identify the radiation intensity. As I have told, we have to measure at a certain distance. Intensity we have to identify. So how we are going to identify, let's see. Always remember that when we are identifying in a certain direction, at direction of R, at a certain point. So we are fixing the one component, that is R component is fixed. But what are the other two components are not fixed? One is theta, one is phi. Remember that. So your intensity will depend upon theta and phi function. So So here I have written u of theta comma phi. U is the radiation intensity. Okay, it depends upon what? It depends upon power. And it depends upon what? It depends upon distance. So what is the relation? Your intensity will have r square into average power. So r square into average power will give you the intensity. Okay, so this intensity we can easily find out. So average power, how we can find out? With the help of radiation power. Here I have represented intensity in terms of average power. You can represent the intensity in terms of radiation power also. How? Let's see. Now as we know, the radiation power is equals to average power into the cross section. So this is the average power and ds is the cross section. Okay, now let's see. For example, this is my point of observation of a particular dipole element. This is the dipole element. Okay, and at the point P, I need to identify the intensity. So when I am analyzing, this will look like as a circular donut. Think that it is a donut and the middle point is the donut is available with the middle point. Okay, if wait a minute. Okay, I have got one donut type. So as you can see that this is a one donut and this is the radiating element. Okay, so this radiating element radiate the electric fields. If you see in a circular manner like this, the magnetic fields are there, but which is coming out and like these curvatures are called as electric fields. Okay, so this is my radiation pattern and this is the radiating element. Okay, so from this radiating element to any of the edges, if you take a distance, so that it will become as a R, and this distance with respect to the axis, it will become as a theta, and if you rotate this one with respect to phi, azimuthal angle, means it is a combination of r, theta and phi for this particular donut. So when we are identifying along r direction, that means the cross section we are identifying at this point P, imaginary cross section. Okay, so this imaginary cross section direction is r, and P average is projected in this particular direction. So average power, when we are projected in this cross section, so cross section must be multiplied to the average power to get the radiated power. This is the concept behind that. Okay, now once this area is identified, that area if you multiply with average power, you will get the radiated power. Now how we are going to identify this area? That for that I will take one recap. If it is spherical system, elemental length, from elemental length I will tell. We have three axes. One is r, one is theta and one is phi. If there is a variation along r, I can write dr dot ar. Done. If it is variation along theta, your radius will remain constant. So here r into d theta dot a theta. Okay, and if phi is varying, then other two factors remain constant, that is called rho d phi dot a phi. So these are the components. Now this I can resolve as dr dot ar, r d theta dot a theta, and this rho component if you convert into represent in terms of spherical, then here rho is equals to r sin theta into d phi dot a phi. So these are the elemental length. Remember this. Elemental length. Now, this is a individual length is there. Variation along r, variation along theta, variation along phi. If it is variation along r, you have to take this. If it is variation along theta, you have to take this. If there is a variation along phi, you have to take this element. Okay. Now, for surface, surface means two dimension must be multiplied. Okay, now here the surface is along r direction, that means which two component is left? Theta and phi. So what is theta? It is r d theta. And what is phi? It is r sin theta. So if I will multiply, I will get r square sine theta d phi dot ar. So this is the cross section through which the average power is projected. And if you multiply the average power with this cross section, you will get your radiated power. That I have written here. So it is average power into the cross section. Cross section is how much? R square sine theta d phi. So it is r square sine theta d phi. Okay? And as we know that average power into r square will give you the intensity. So here I have written r square into average as intensity. U of theta comma phi sine theta and d phi. Now the sine theta and d phi is called as a solid angle. Remember that. Because in this donut, when I am identifying this one as a radiating element, at any point if you take, the sum part will be taken off at any point. Theta will be there, phi will be there, r will be there. In certain r direction, theta and phi. If you multiply these two, you will get your solid angle. So that solid angle is represented as a d omega. Remember this. D omega is equals to sine theta and d phi. And whose unit is steradian, SR. Okay. So here I have written P rad is equals to U theta comma phi, U of theta comma phi, sine theta and d phi. Now what is the variation of this theta, because it is a cross section? Your theta will vary from 0 to pi, phi will vary from 0 to 2 pi. So here I can write theta lies between 0 to pi, phi lies between 0 to 2 pi. Okay. So if you take these values directly, integrate this value, 0 to 2 pi sin theta, 0 to 2 0 to pi sin theta and 0 to 2 pi d phi, you will get 4 pi if you solve it. Okay. So if you solve the maximum value, this sin theta d theta and d phi, you will get 4 pi. So that directly I have written U average is equals to radiated power divided by 4 pi. So this is called my radiation intensity average, average radiation intensity, which depends upon average power also, which depends upon radiation power also. So this is the basic steps through which we can determine the radiation intensity. First, general equation, identify the relation first. Determine the power radiation, power average, solid angle, multiply the solid angle with average power, with intensity. So solid angle with intensity will give you radiated power. If you determine U of theta comma phi, that is radiated power divided by the solid angle. So solid angle maximum value will be 4 pi. Okay. Now how this 4 pi comes? It is a simple one. We have d omega, that is surface. In place of d omega, I will put sine theta, d phi. Sine theta, d theta. Theta varies from 0 to pi. And d phi varies from 0 to 2 pi. So this d phi will become 2 pi. Sine theta is minus cos theta. 0 to pi. If you substitute, you will get 4 pi. Done. Then what is left? U average. So what is U average? U average is P rad divided by 4 pi. So this is the basic relation behind this intensity, radiation intensity. So this is the radiation intensity. Next we will discuss about the directive gain. The directive gain, power gain, beam efficiency, antenna aperture and this effective height we will discuss in the next class, and if time permits we will solve few numericals. Okay, till then go through these all relations. The soft copy of that book I will share in that Google Drive. You can go through the steps step by step, but in that book directly the values are given, the steps are not available. Okay, so go through this thing. There are different sort of resources are there. You can analyze with respect to different books, different lecture notes, all things are available. First of all, you need to understand what is the antenna basic parameter, then we will enter to the type of antenna and how to analyze it. Okay, so next class, rest of the part, whatever is left, we will go through. Till then, thank you.